something was coming down, just wiped away to be a church at all costs. With what is going on now, we must sow the seed of the gospel. 100 years from now, it's very difficult for our great grandchildren to be Christians. And that is the battle that we're fighting. And the Bible says, you will be there that are peace in Zion. Please not allow time for us to be living careless lives, to be wasting our resources, when there is so much to do for the kingdom of God. Thank you. So we need to really pray hard and join this effort of reaching the lost. The little fire we set in Burkina Faso is burning so bright and bright now. Many more churches, almost 200 combat spots, have made a way of doing this. 3 years ago, I was going to say, we're building up the work there. Today, over 3,000 Muslims are now in the church who are following themselves. So, I believe that if we obey, God will bless us as a people. And I was telling my mission coordinator for the family food, Pastor Bernard, who was teaching and his wife yesterday, that I wish we can really find some young men who can set up a very strong armed business, well capitalized, that 50% of the profit will be coming from the mission. And we are doing this because we understand the urgency of the time. It's not just about ourselves. It takes a lot of money. Only we cannot raise the money on this one. Try. But all of us need to understand what is here. And one thing that we fix in is the spirit of poverty. And I believe that we can conquer poverty if we are determined to be honest, transparent, and very truthful in serving God. So, I have to share some of this to you this morning to understand where we are coming from. And this morning, I'm going to continue my teaching from where I stopped my last time. I've been talking about the principles that we need to apply. Please, I want every parent to control their children, children teachers, control the children. I don't want kids making noise or running around. If any child is crying, please take them out immediately. Because this is a very important moment for us. And I just pray that everyone of you will understand the need of the moment and keep into it to see what contribution we can make to expand the kingdom of God on earth. The results we have gotten shows that if we go, He will hear us. And those of you who feel that you can enter business so that you can make money and serve God, I would like to meet all of us who want to do that. Professionals, businessmen, and some of them next week, 9 o'clock. In fact, 8:30, so that prayer will just start again. So that we can come and just sit down and talk. Anybody who's interested in business, anybody who is already in business, anybody who's a professional, whatever you're doing, let's just come down, sit together, and look at things the way God wants us to see. And pray and see what will come out of that meeting. So Precious God, we thank you this morning for your faithfulness. We thank you for being gracious to us, for keeping us and keeping us. Too many trouble, you take them forth to bring them back. We are thankful. I pray this morning, Lord, that the Holy Spirit will teach us, motivate us, that we get up and move in the right direction. That we may keep it to this revival that we've been talking about. That we will experience it. Everyone, let it fire upon. Holy Spirit, come. We yield to you. Thank you. In Jesus' name. Amen. So my last message, I'm going to define what revival is. And one key element that will make revival work comes through repentance. And today, I'm going to give you five key principles on how to know that you are already living in revival. How the church can know that revival has started. So when we know it, we will not ask ourselves the questions. Is this happening? If it's not, we are not in the Bible. And what can we do? Seek God for the Bible. The first thing we're going to look at is that forget to be a reminder. Of those who live a reminder are people who live a separated life. And the second one is that those who live a reminder are filled with spirit prayer. That's prayer in the Holy Ghost. The third thing we want to look at is that Christians who live with the fire of the Bible are those who walk aggressively to reach the lost. And the fourth one is that Christians who experience the Bible have uncontrollable and unquenchable joy in their lives. And lastly, those who live in revival love the Word of God and cherish it. If you didn't get all that, I'm going to cover them in my teaching this morning. So, number one, we talked about Christians who live a life of revival. First, there are those separated their lives from the world and the worldly things that are around them. Matthew chapter 5, from verse 6, it says, I read, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. They shall be satisfied, or they shall be filled. Blessed are those who hunger. Hunger. When you are very hungry, what do you look for? You look for food. So if there is deep hunger within your heart for God, and you thirst for Him, like you thirst for water, and you thirst for righteousness, like you thirst for water, the Bible says, one, you will be satisfied and you will be filled. And that's why James tells us in his Epistle chapter 4, verse 4, ye adulterers and adulteresses, know ye not that the friendship of the world is enmity with God? Whosoever therefore be a friend of the world is the enemy of God. Whosoever will be a friend of the world will be an enemy of God. So if we are living in a revival, the first one we have to see in our life is a separation from the world. Today, the world is struggling very much to approach the life of the universe. We dance their music, we sing their song, watch their videos, we imitate their dressing, not to please ourselves, but to please the Almighty God. And that is why the Bible tells us in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 14. 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 14. Be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness? And what communion hath light with darkness? Verse 17. Wherefore, come out from among them, and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you, and I will be a father unto you. Verse 18. And ye shall be my sons and daughters, saith the Almighty God. So a revival that we cannot separate ourselves from the world is not real. It's not revival. The moment there's a revival in the church, everybody is ready to separate from the system of the world and begin to work on godly principles. And the Bible says, when we separate ourselves from the world, we attach ourselves to God. And it's a God will not with our Father. And God will bless us because we now operate on the system and not the system of the world. How does it feel when God looks at you and God in his son? My daughter, it is only those who are separated from the things of the world that can experience revival. Some people think that revival means bringing him to the evangelist here. You will preach with power and then demonstrate and gyrate and do all kinds of gymnastics. And everybody will stand with their head, pulling in and shouting, amen, yeah, amen, fire, yeah. And this is what people call revival. Immediately service is over, they go to fall down again. When that happens, that's not revival. Revival is the thing of the spirit that controls your conduct, that enhances your vision to align with God's vision and see things the way God sees things and obey God in all his commands. And when people look at us, they see God in us. All these are powerful scriptures that will get us into the mood of revival. And the question this morning is, how separated are you from the world? How separated are you from the world? What is the evidence that God moves you? What can you point to this morning and say, God rules in their life? Young people, what can you point to this morning and say, God rules in their life? Their secret practices, their lies, their disobedience, their self-will, the static, the laziness. Who rules your life? Who is your hero? Some of you, your heroes are the popular footballers. Your heroes are the popular filmmakers, actors. And these actors say some very weird things that will damage your Christian life. That will damage your Christian life. I was reading one on the internet the other day, and it says that he does not live by religious restrictions because those things are outmoded. If I want to sleep with any man, it's my choice, and I make sure it is somebody I can enjoy. And there's nothing about it because it's my body. Your body. Your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. And they have no peace about it. No guilt any longer. And I was reading another one, and it says that before you whether they will help you to any means. I know whether they walk or not. And if it doesn't, just walk away. There is no godly foundation, no godly principle that people are following to obey the words of God. There are young men that say, unless you become pregnant, I cannot pay your dowry. And the woman is busy trying to get pregnant by that man. You don't know who has the problem. And by the time you are spent like a man, he leaves you and you go. And your life is empty and broken. No willpower to say no. No willpower to resist the devil. And yet, you are a child of God. And you come to the church. The most consideration. He said, do not hate on people in the world with unbelievers. You married believers, who are your friends? There are many women with foul mouths. When they start talking, now everything just goes bad. Nothing edifying comes out of their mouth. And instead of long enough, they become polluted and become like that. What do you do? Who is you? Who is influencing you? As old as you are, another woman in another man's house is teaching you how to marry your husband and telling you what you can take and what you cannot take. And you go home and you are acting it out. Are you not stupid? The word of God is what should direct you. To understand the principle of marriage based on the word of God. And when you walk in line with God, there is plenty of joy and blessing in that life. Whether your husband is rich or poor, it does not matter. You will be a godly man. You will be a godly man. And for those of you brothers, that your eyes are all over the place, you are just like a rolling stone and that has moved. What kind of life are you showing your children? What kind of life are you living? Is God the center of that life? When you start cheating, you start lying, you start doing things on your own, and one will plea, it's just unfortunate what people do. And they say, they're Christians. What kind of life do you want to live? I was with a young man. He's just about 23. They worked for me for a while briefly. Today, they will call him here, he will get sad. Tomorrow, they will call him here, there's much trouble. What's going on? Eventually, I found out that all the three people who call him every day are women who are asking him for money to pay for their sons because he has got three children from three different women at 23. And so by the time he's 40, how many children will he have? And there are still foolish girls that are following those men. Who is the next victim? What kind of life are you living, young men? You know, these days I just have to tell you the truth so that we can come back to business. Do we need revival? Do we need revival? So please, don't be annoyed, but we listen, open your ears. Truth is not what's running away from the church. Every day all we hear is, God will prosper you, God will bless you, God will make this happen to you. God, what are you doing for God? Separate yourself. These are commands from the Bible. Come out from among them. Touch from the unclean thing. That is where the separation begins. And when you are dedicated unto the Lord, you will marry in a holy manner, not like the unbelievers do. And God will bless that marriage. Hallelujah. If you separate yourself from the Lord, you do business as a Christian, and God will bless that business. If you separate yourself from the world, some of the sicknesses and diseases that are happening will not be able. There is so much that we gain than what we need. But the world will tell you, are you now Mary Magdalene? Are you not Mary, the mother of Jesus? Nothing like that anymore. Virginity is an old fashioned. You have to do this. Be a shining star wherever you are. This is what God has called us to do. Please come with me again to that 2 Corinthians chapter 6. We're going to read verse 14, verse 17, and verse 18. 2 Corinthians chapter 6. Shall we all stand up and read it together? If you have a Bible, even this telephone Bible you have, you can read it also. I use both. Okay. Are we all ready now? Verse 14. Go. Let's start from the beginning again. Everybody, no matter your passion, go. Be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness? And what communion hath light with darkness? Verse 17. Wherefore, come out from among them, and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you. Verse 18. And will be a father unto you, and ye shall be my sons and daughters, saith the Lord. Come to somebody and say, do you believe this? Ask that person, do you believe this? Please help me ask another person, what do you do now? Get an answer for me. So what did you hear from them? What did you hear? They are ready to be sitting in a life of separation. And you know, God does not leave us in a vacuum. You have this. When you separate from the world, you join unto the Lord. Are you seeing? And when you leave the world, you join unto the world. So, we must understand that what you look out for is how separated am I from the world system, from tradition, from culture, and how am I aligned with God? Number two, revival stirs up unquenchable spirit and prayer. Those who live in revival pray a lot. They pray to be closer to God. They pray for the church. They pray for the lost. They pray for world evangelism. They pray for God to visit the community where their churches are, so that souls will be open to the gospel of Jesus Christ and come to know Him as God has said. They pray about everything. Their life is a life of prayer. But you know, this morning, it's possible there are some people sitting there looking at me, they did not pray with the world. They just jump into the bathroom, have their breakfast, and start coming to church. They didn't read their Bible. There's no discipline for that. And when you live that kind of life, it's good revival. Because revival comes to conscious search for God. And one of the ways is through prayer. Prayer is a powerful tool. Prayer is a powerful tool. The psalmist once said, as a deer pants for flowing streams, so pants my soul for you, O God. My soul thirsts for you, for the living God. My soul thirsts for you. A man like this will always pray, God. My soul thirsts for you, O God. I cannot go without you. I'm hungry for you, O God. I need you, O God. Come into my life, O God. Cleanse me, O God. Empower me, O God. Help me, O God, to do your will in everything. suddenly found out that God had provided all those things. Whatever you need to be, God can give you children, God can give you a good wife, God can give you a good house, God can give you anything. But that's not the business of the We are seeking Him for who He is. We are taking Him serious for who He is. But if you look at Psalm 107, the Bible says that the God of Moses was not known by the Israelites, but they only looked for the blessings that God had. They did not want to know the God of Moses, but they wanted the blessings that God had. And that's the generation we are living in today. Bless me, bless me, bless me, bless me, God. And everybody wants to be happy. God doesn't want to make you happy. God wants you to be joyful all the days of your life. Joy is deeper than happiness. Because happiness is momentary. Today you are happy, tomorrow you are sad. But when there is joy in you, there is a river that flows in your heart that cannot be stopped by anything. Hallelujah. So God is calling us to a life of prayer. Open up an inner well within us that no man can quench. And that is why the book of James, chapter 4, verse 8, tells us, come near to God, and He will come near to you. Come near to God, and He will come near to you. Three scriptures that we have seen. My soul hungers after you and thirsts. Like first Peter. The Bible says they shall be satisfied. They shall be filled. And as we are hungry and we are seeking Him and we are praying and we are calling upon His name, suddenly God comes into His temple. I pray that this 2019 Grace Evangelism Mission Headquarters, we can bring the manifestation of the presence of God in a powerful way because we hunger after righteousness, because we seek Him, because we are deep prayer and communion with Him. God who sees our heart will pour out the Spirit of God measurelessly in this place. And everyone will know that God is in this place. And God is coming in this place. Can somebody shout it again? Yeah. That is what I'm looking forward to. So we have looked at two important things. The life of separation and the life of prayer. The thought that we see here is that Christians who live the life of revival are soul winners. They go after soul. Go to the highway, go to the byway. Whether they are people, whether they are men, whatever they are, jobless, uneducated, learned, lawyers, doctors, reach out to everybody. Bring them into the kingdom of God. Because before the eyes of God, the most uncivilized human being is as important to God as the most, as the greatest professor that is in our time. You understand that? God does not discriminate against people. He wants every one of us to go forth and seek that which is lost. Now, when the church begins to receive this anointing of the Holy Spirit, we see that it motivates us to be doing it. Because we will always ask ourselves, what exactly is the kind of God in this day and time? Luke chapter 19, verse 10. Here the Bible tells us, for the Son of God, or for the Son of Man, came to seek and to save that which was lost. And every disciple is supposed to be like his master. What are we supposed to be doing? Seeking the lost, so that they can become saved. There is nobody here who cannot find somebody. Somebody who is a sinner. Somebody who does not know Jesus Christ as a Lord and Savior. He may have heard about Jesus. He may have heard about church. He must have gone to church, but he's not born again. These are the people that God wants each one of us to reach out to if we are going to experience the great revival. If you study the book of Acts, chapter 8, beginning from verse 1, there the Bible a drug of both men and women and put them in prison. This was the havoc that Saul and his men read that in the church. They were destroying them, pulling down their buildings and places of worship, take them into prison, stop this madness of calling Jesus. And so when this happened, the Christians were discovered everywhere. Today, it is happening in our own country. Over 1 million people have been displaced, Christians. Over 900 churches have been destroyed in Yobe, Boru, Adamawa, and Zakwara. Over 900 churches in the past 10 years. And Christians have been scattered everywhere. The same thing happened in the Bible. But look at verse 4. It says, those who had been scattered. I can't finish reading this now, please. Is it in your Bible? Acts chapter 8, verse 4. Just sit down and open it and let us read it together. Everybody, read what you see here. No. Everybody, read what you see in that passage. Look at your Bible. Go. Verse 4. They have no home now. They have no clothes. When you are running for your life, you remember your commando, your suitcase, your belt. So they were running for their life. And the first day they stopped, what did they do? They did. If it's today, what will happen to us? This is what happened. They were so saturated in the word of God that they cannot keep quiet. Jeremiah was called by God. He suffered so many persecution. And one day he told God, I will not preach again to anybody. I'm tired. So he went to his house and sat down. And the word of God filled his heart. And he said, the word was so strong in my stomach. And then he went home. And my body was quaking. He could not stand. So he stood up and began to prophesy to me. This is the Bible. When we are so loaded with the word of God, we cannot stop. We have to preach this gospel. These are men and women who were thrown out of their homes. They ran the other cities to seek refuge. But the first thing they did whenever they went was to preach the gospel. How many of us now that there is no persecution? This month of May, how many of us are speaking to one person? You go to church, yes, that's fine. How many of us have shared the gospel with one person? Some of us will say, no. This week, how many of us have shared the gospel with someone? Some of us will say, no. Since January, how many of us have shared the gospel with someone? It's only inside crying. That tells you exactly where you are. You cannot end up. Many days in the Bible, lack of money cannot stop the gospel. When there is no Bible, I have no food cannot stop the gospel. When there is no Bible, I have no money to pay school fees for my children cannot stop the gospel. No matter the way you are, you still speak the word of God. This is what happened in the New Testament. The life of sharing the gospel. This is the assignment of the church. This is what Jesus gave his life for. This is the last wish and command he left for us. As I leave you, go into the world, preach the gospel of repentance to everyone that believes and they shall be saved. And when we forget this, any other thing we are doing in the church is wrong. And this is just the truth. By the time I started speaking in Sierra Leone last Sunday, because throughout the week I was reading one paper at the end, but something was enlightening us. Pastors stood on their necks and they were crying. We have missed the mark. Everybody has to come back to Jesus. We were lost. We were dead. You have brought us back to life. can you start by telling them what's the meaning of Jesus and treat them as a Christian? They can say Christ to you. But your husband can say, my name in your house, I put my life in Christ. Not be treating them like animals, they will now tell you about Jesus. They will never accept that call that you will present, which is a big deal. Jesus will change us in the living room. Can you now talk to a fellow man in the marketplace? Can you talk to your neighbors in the club? Can people now call me a Bible freak? Who are you sharing the gospel with? What is Christianity to you? This is the job of the church. And I would like to help you to come into a revival if you will drag yourself out of that place you are right now. And say, Lord, help me believe in my life. So this is not what revival is. Not what you are thinking revival is. You know? Number four. Sorry, question number three. So Acts chapter 3, we see that Paul will restore this people. And verse 5 and 6, the Bible says in the midst of this persecution, Philip went down to Samaria and proclaimed the Messiah. And the crowds heard and saw the signs he performed. They all paid close attention to what he said. The moment the Samaritan pastors cried to God and repented during this conference over there, we began to pray. We had about 1, 2, 3, 4 speakers, 2 Americans, 2 Nigerians. We began to pray. The Holy Ghost came down. Demons began to cry out. The kingdom of God started acting immediately. And we asked him, where was this power before? Right there. Repentance has come. And God began to move. And that God changed the movie. And I want to assure you what I saw, what I experienced. If we prepare ourselves, we will see the power of God like never before. Philip went out. In spite of the persecution, God backed him up. And because of that power that he welded, the people gave attention because they did not know what this was all about. Number four. We see also that the Bible creates great joy in the heart of the believer. Joy is what makes you apply your Bible, and when you are going to church, you are blowing whistle and you are singing, and you are happy, and people will think you have all of you. No! Joy is what makes you want to come to church and go to the front seat and not the back seat, and then you begin to praise God and begin to worship God. There are some who will sit at the back because they have ascended to give the people's walking. But those of us who are in revival, we never like to be in the back seat. Hallelujah! We want to be in the front where it happens. But today, what shall we say? Please go forward. You say, no, I want to go back. I want to stay near the door. So that before they say the grace, you are gone. Revival will place a door in your heart. That's what I'm doing in the church. Every brother is a brother. You don't get back to the body. You don't speak evil against anybody. Your tongue is cleansed. Your attitude is cleansed. You don't foul the root of any other people by what you see and then you talk to them. Why? Because there's a power in your life. What you carry is joy. And anybody you meet, joy will flow in that person. Hallelujah. I remember one brother, we called him Brother Hallelujah. Once he comes into your house, the first thing you say, Hallelujah. Who is in this house? So they know him as Brother Hallelujah. They feel joy with him. He's always smiling. He became so infectious that other people joined him. Brother Hallelujah, how are you? And I found that when you say Hallelujah, you are smiling already. Because joy comes out of himself. Where is your joy? Where is your joy? The city for happiness? No. Yes, happiness comes with everything you have. But the day somebody hits you, that happiness disappears, isn't it? And you become very angry and start acting on it. Joy is good when you do the new thing you said, but when you're a child, I mean, you scream, then you enjoy it. Happiness leads you, but joy will always stay no matter what happens. How many of us believe in joy of the Lord? Let me stand on this mountain and sing that song. Let joy of the Lord
is my strength. Let joy.
Is my strength. Jesus came out of many, and many who were paralyzed or lame were healed. So there was great joy in the city. That is what happens when the Spirit of God begins to impact our lives. And we will now come finally to number 5. Revival comes when there is a new love for the Word of God. Revival comes when there is new love for the Word of God. For some of us, the Word of God has grown more weak. For some of us, it is mundane. For some of us, it's outdated. And we're trying to make sense out of this ancient book of over 2,000 years, how it can be relevant to this modern age. This is church age. Everybody wants to fly. Civilization comes, civilization goes. But the Word of God will be constant. And I can see the Word of God that was spoken 6,000 years ago, how relevant it is in our heart. Now, what does the Word of God in the Old Testament? Ezra chapter 7, verse 10. Ezra chapter 7, verse 10. It says, let me give you time to find it. Ezra chapter 10, verse 7. We are going to walk from chapter 7, chapter 9 to chapter 10. And you see something there that will really amaze you. The book of Ezra. Okay. So here I said that when the new love for the Word of God, when revival comes, and if you don't eat the Word in a day, you will not be happy. You will even be able to draw a timetable. Like in my training in the mission field, I will always ask them, how many times are you eating this morning? And the first time that everybody will say once, I say, what did you eat? Bread and tea and sugar. Only once, I say, they say yes. And I'll tell them, me, I've eaten twice this morning. They say, ah, and who gave you food in your room? I say, well, I picked up my bag. This is the first food I ate this morning. And then this one I'm eating is my second ration. Are you hearing me? One for the spirit, one for the body. Ah, everybody will just say, wow. I said, I don't know if I eating twice this morning. Two people may just say, yeah. Then tomorrow morning I'll ask the same question again. How many of you are eating twice this morning? I will see everybody having goes up. They begin to form the habit of eating the Word of God before they even eat His love. And by the time you finish, everybody is soaked in the Word of God. And anywhere you tell them to go, they are ready to go. Praise the name of God. So we see this transformation take place in people every day. And we want it to come to us because everywhere I go, people are looking for God to come to see where I come from. And they believe that what they are seeing in this world is received in the church. And if they come and it's not so, what's going to happen? We must be first partakers of what we are giving to people. Very important. There will be no revival no matter what we do without the Word of God. Because the Word of God is going to channel and direct everything we do. Because without the Word of God, we can walk into error or spiritism, into cult, thinking it's revival, and it's not revival. The Word is the one that will guide our heart, that will be the lamp that shows us the way in the dark alleys of this life. The Word of God. Because we have so many revivals, and so many people start coming with dreams and visions and everything, and people pay attention to these things, and they carry them away out of the Word of God. And what happens? The next day, the revival is dead. So that's not what we're talking about. Revival will be directed by the Word of God, because it's the author of revival. And revival simply means to remain alive, acting like God. Every day of your life. To be alive in the spirit, not just breathing in your body. Doing the will of God. Ezra chapter 7. Have you all seen it? Please join me. Let us read verse 10. Everybody read together. Go. For Ezra has devoted himself to study and observe the law of the Lord and to teach its decrees and laws in Israel. What did Ezra do? They have sinned. God has punished them. They were in misery. And suddenly this man discovered the Word of the Lord. And this is one of the great grandsons of the Lord. know the will of God and you start teaching it to the people. That was his mystery. Now, look at what happened. Chapter 9, verse 4. Chapter 9, verse 4. Then everyone who trembled at the words of God, everyone who trembled at the word of God of Israel, gathered around me because of this unfaithfulness of the exile. So what happened to Ezra? He made up his mind to start teaching the word of the Lord, and his life became so effective that all the people in Israel began to draw to him to listen to these words that Ezra was teaching. Look at that, chapter 10, verse from verse 1. From chapter 10, it says, while Ezra was praying and confessing, weeping and throwing himself down before the house of God, a large crowd of Israelites, men, women, and children gathered around him. They too wept bitterly. So this number started growing. Everybody started recognizing their sin. And all of them, the pastor was crying, the members were crying, everybody was crying. Why were they crying? Who stopped them? Who beat them? The conviction of the Holy Spirit. It is stronger than any pain anyone can feel. All of them were weeping bitterly. Our hearts are broken. And that's why God can speak to us. That's why we are lost in our stubbornness and heaviness. Because nobody can change your idea, your opinion, and tell you the right thing to do. We are too hard for God. But the word of God never just speaking because they rested in the spirit of revival. Their sins were before them and they began to cry to God. They began to cry to God. Let's look at one and see what's going on here. You look at verse 2. He says, then Shechaniah, sons of Jehiel, one of the descendants of Eli, said to Ezra, we have been unfaithful to our Lord by marrying foreign women from the peoples around us. But in spite of this, there is still hope for Israel. I like his optimism. Now, verse 3. Let us make a covenant before our God to set away all these women and their children in accordance with the counsel of my Lord. And those who fear the commands of our God, let it be done according to the law. Verse 9. Within 3 days, this revival is now spreading. On the third day, all the men of Judah and Benjamin had gathered in Jerusalem. And on the 20th day of the ninth month, that's September month, all the people were sitting in the square before the house of God, greatly distressed by the occasion and because of the rain. Verse 10, then Ezra, the priest, stood up and said to them, you have been unfaithful. You have married foreign women, adding to Israel's guilt. That means what you have done is adding to other sins that you have committed. Verse 11, now, honor the Lord of your ancestors, and do his will. Separate yourselves from the people around you and from the foreign wives. The whole assembly was told, responded with a loud voice. You are right. We must do as you say. Hallelujah. Repentance brings you to a place of action. And action will lead to do away with so many things. In this instance, one of the sins was leaving the children of Israel and going about to marry strange wives. Why is it important to do away with strange wives in those days? Number one, if you remember King Ahab, he started with the Lord. A man in Jezebel who was not faithful. And Jezebel came into his house with the gods of Baal. And before you know it, Ahab had started worshipping Baal. And Baal And you know the battle it took God to return Israel. Elijah has to appear on the scene and declare the war. And that day, fire has to come from heaven before the land of Israel. So, children of God, when you begin to play around with unbelieving women who don't know God, they will destroy their spiritual life. Young girls, when you begin to play around with young boys who are nothing but playboys and you are toys in their hand, they will destroy your life. The enemy is separate from these things and come back to God and say, I'd rather than to be in the hand of an unbeliever, then you are ready for God. So, the way of the cross is not as convenient. And people are asking the question. Today, we have unbelieving wives, we have unbelieving husbands. What do we do? Remember, the Old Testament people are walking in the shadow with lights and shadows to show us what true godliness is. But Jesus Christ came to fulfill the law, and there is a change. Now, let us look at 1 Corinthians chapter 7, so that you can compare it to what we have just seen in the time of Israel. What Israel did was perfectly alright. The wives, the children, that they belonged, and give them away, go back to the hidden people. You see? And so, what we know, but that is cruel. How can you allow your children to go to the hidden? But that is the Old Testament. Separate yourselves and be with me. But in the New Testament, look at what God did now. From verse 12 of 1 Corinthians chapter 7. But to the rest, sorry, where are we now? Okay. But to the rest speak I, not the Lord. If any brother hath a wife that believe not, and she be pleased to dwell with him, let him not put her away. Are you hearing that? In other words, the wife is an unbeliever, he said, don't divorce her. You will see the reason. Verse 13. And the woman which hath an husband that believe not, and if he be pleased to dwell with her, let her not leave him. Your husband is not a believer, and he still wants to live with you. He said, please don't leave him. That's what the Bible is teaching us in the New Testament, which is a bit different from what Ezra did. And I explained to you why Ezra had to do it. Okay? Because they live with pipe and shadows. And they have to demonstrate this thing physically to show what purity is all about. But in the New Testament, the grace God provided speaks something much higher. Okay? So, from verse 13 and from verse 14, for the unbelieving husband is sanctified by the wife, and the unbelieving wife is sanctified by the husband. Else were your children unclean. You see why Ezra sent them out? The children are polluted by their mother. He bring them to Israel, they will still pollute the land. The children will be unclean. But in the New Testament, if the believing partner is serving us sincerely, evangelizing her home very well, evangelizing this home very well, your presence here will bring sanctification to your children, and they are clean because we started thinking in a godly way. I hope you're getting the point. And that is why it's important. This is the word of grace. It's not an easy job. It is a good one. God's grace now brings those children in. And so because of the presence of the godly partner, those children can be sanctified and made holy. And friends, I've seen many women who have never given Christ, even though the man is better than God now. I've seen many men who have never given Christ, even though their wife is not a godly woman. And I've seen wives who have cried and said, my husband, I've not seen a man like him. He literally talked to God when he knew something. And finally brought me to Jesus Christ. I've seen it the other way around. And our prayer in this church is that every unbelieving wife and every unbelieving husband will see God in their partner. See God strong enough when two of you are displaying the same character, there will be no salvation, and your children will not be clean. That's the word of God. Are we ready for revival? Are we ready for revival? I've said very strong things this morning. Out of love and passion, that we all should become members of God and the people of God. So that everybody can go home after this service and begin to pray for yourself and prepare yourself for the Bible. In case you did not get everything that I've said, let me repeat the outlines of this message again. Number one, I said, for then if we want to be in the Bible, there will be separation from the world unto God. Number two, we must get to a place where the spirit of prayer takes over and prevails in the church. Number three, we will become people who are aggressively pursuing soul winning in the house of God. And number four, there will be joy that is unquenchable, that comfort will begin to sound up in the Bible. And number five, God's word will become the center of our lives because we love and cherish the Bible literally. When these five things are found in your life, not one of them, you four, and one is missing, is incomplete. All these five are like the five fingers, all are important. Go home and meditate. Listen to me. So this man that we're talking about, the Bible, is about the fourth lesson. When will we experience the God? As we begin to gravitate towards this eternal lives, the Bible will come. If we say next Saturday we want to pray, you will see more people here praying. If there's no revival, they will like what their vision and what other things they like to do, they will not come. Want a good witnessing? They will not come. Women have program, they will not show up. Men want to do this, they will not show up. The youth, their action, they will not show up. But if there is a Bible, everybody will be gravitating towards the things of God in the church. It is the force that drives your God. And I want us to really wake up this morning that we all begin to run towards God in our lives. Bow down your heads for the next day. How many of us this know that you need to bow down here? And you want to see this now from this very day in your life. Just raise your right hand because I'm going to pray for you wherever you are. Thank you. We need our power. Thank you. We need our power. God bless that you. How many of us think we need our power? Please raise that hand up properly. Please not tell you the shield of anybody. I need it myself. My deacons need it. My ministers need it. Everybody needs it. Let me see those hands. We need a provider in our lives. Thank you very much. Stand up on your feet. God will never lose your hands. Come and pray. Because God wants to do something new in our lives. God wants to do something new in our lives. Why are you going to do this? God is an awesome God. And I like how most of you are doing this. Open your heart to God. Say, awesome God, invade my life. Let me begin to see that blessing, that power to serve you, to live for you, to defend God.
Control.
It's a awesome. run out of God, this afternoon, and say, God, I come to you right now. You're my healer. You're my restorer. Maybe